I hereby call the Finance Committee meeting for March 20th, 2017 to order. Councilors, just a point of information, this is being taped, it is not live. I was told that we're having an issue with one of the boxes there, so it will be aired tomorrow, but it will not be live as of tonight.
Right.
And with that being said, Councilor Cruz. Councilors, please stand. Councilor Cruz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to take a minute for a moment of silence. The City of Brockton, and in fact, the state of Massachusetts, lost a true public servant this past week, a man who epitomized what public service was as a judge. He was a fair and compassionate man. As a city solicitor, he was a great guide to Mayor Units and his team. Judge Cortland Mathers passed away this past week, and I'd like to have a moment of silence in his memory. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you. May you rest in peace. He was an honorable man, and he was definitely the definition of public servant. So thank you for that, Councilor. Councilors, just a couple housekeeping. Larry Rowley, DPW Commissioner, is unable to join us. He's outside of the Commonwealth tonight. He had another engagement. And also, Mr. Casiri, Jim Casiri, Building Superintendent, was on vacation this week. And then lastly, we did get correspondence from our State Senator, Michael D. Brady. And the Senator can't join us tonight, so when we get to Council Beauregard's resolve, we will entertain a motion to postpone that. If we could go, Madam Clerk, to agenda number one, please.
Appointment of Carlene DeRosa Brizard of Brockton to the Brockton Commission on Women's Issues for a year term ending March 2018. Invited Carlene DeRosa Brizard.
Is Ms. Brizard here?
All of the women are here.
Oh, you having a team meeting out there?
It's a ladies thing.
Oh, here they come.
Is Ms. Brizard in the chamber?
Yes.
If she could please come up to the podium, Ms. Brizard.
They're doing shots before they came in.
Why don't we have them all come up?
Yeah, have them all come up once.
Good evening. How are you tonight? You could please join us. We didn't know you were out there. We just read the appointment, which was just your name and the position and your address. Do you have any statement you want to make to the Finance Committee relative to this appointment?
I know. I'm just very honored to be part of it.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Motion to recommend favorable.
Second.
Motion made properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back to the full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, our motion carries. Thank you very much. We'll vote on it at the next full city council meeting. Madam Clerk, number two, please.
Appointment of Ruth Moore of Brockton to the Brockton Commission on Women's Issues for a one-year term ending March 2018, invited Ruth Moore.
Ms. Moore, good evening.
Good evening.
How are you tonight?
Very well.
Thank you for joining us. Do you have a statement for the Finance Committee members? Do you have any statement at all?
Statement,
yes.
No,
nothing. Okay.
Motion to recommend favorably to the full
Motion
city
made
council.
Properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, that motion carries. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
It's a favorable recommendation back to the full council. Madam Clerk, number three, please.
Appointment, Lisa Duquette of Brockton to the Brockton Commissions on Women's Issues for a one-year term ending March 2018, invited Lisa Duquette.
Ms. Duquette, good evening.
Good evening.
How are you?
Fine.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Do you have a statement for the council members?
No, thank you.
Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
There's a motion on the floor. It was properly seconded. It's a favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, that motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Thank you. Good evening. Number four, please.
Appointment of Anne-Marie Nee of Brockton to the Brockton Commission on Women's Issues for a two-year term ending March 2019. Invited Anne-Marie Nee.
Ms. Nee. Ms. Nee's not here in attendance right now.
Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
Yeah, we'll take a motion, and it's properly seconded. It's favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed. Motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Number five, please.
Appointment of Janice Lemieux of Brockton to the Brockton Commission on Women's Issues for a two-year term ending March 2019. Invited Janice Lemieux.
Mrs. Lemieux, good evening.
Good evening.
How are you?
Fine. How about yourself?
Good, thank you. Do you have a statement for us, or?
I'm just happy to serve the city of Brockton. Thank
Excellent.
You.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Thank you, Council. Motion made properly. Second. Favorable recommendation. Back to the full council. All in favor? All opposed. That motion carries. Favorable recommendation. Thank you very much. Madam Clerk, number six, please.
Appointment of Leona Martin of Brockton to the Brockton Commission on Women's Issues for a two-year term ending March 2019. Invited Leona Martin.
Ms. Martin, good evening.
Good evening.
How are you?
I'm great.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Do you have a statement for us?
I just want to say that I am delighted to be able to serve the women of Brockton.
Excellent.
Move to recommend favorably to the full City Council.
Motion on the floor is properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back to the full council. All in favor? All opposed? That motion carries. Thank you very much, Ms. Martin. It's favorable recommendation back to full council. Number seven, please.
Appointment of Maria DePina Montero of Brockton to the Brockton Commission on Women's Issues for a two-year term ending March 2019. Invited Maria DePina Montero.
Good evening. How are you?
Great. Yourself?
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
A statement for us?
It's my pleasure, you know, to be in the women's community, to be part of it.
Excellent.
Motion recommend favorably. Second.
Motion made. It's properly seconded. It's favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor? All opposed? That motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Thank you. Have a good evening. Madam Clerk, we're going to go to number eight, please.
Appointment of Nicole Gatling of Brockton to the Brockton Commission on Women's Issues for a three-year term ending March 2020. Invited Nicole Gatling.
Good evening.
Good evening.
How are you?
Good, thank you.
Do you have a statement for us, sir?
Just happy to serve.
Awesome.
Move to recommend favorably to the City Council.
Motion made, properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor? All opposed? That motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Favorable recommendation back to full council.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Beauregard. Councilor Izak, I'm sorry.
I just wanted to thank all the women for their service and for being here tonight. Thank you.
I echo the sentiments of the Council President. Thank you for your service. You're going to do great yeoman's work for the City of Brockton, so thank you very much. With that being said, I'm going to entertain a motion, Council Beauregard, relative to agenda item number 18. Do you want to make a motion to take that out of order?
Yes, I recommend that
we motion on the floor. Can we get a second on that?
Second.
Motion made properly second. We're going to take agenda item number 18 out of order. There's no one in opposition to that, right? Okay, motion carries. Madam Clerk, number 18, please.
Resolved to invite Mr. Joseph Cardinal of National Grid to the City Council to provide more information regarding the condition of 136 manhole covers located throughout the city, and if any further action will be taken to resolve this issue. Invited Joe Cardinal, Manager, Community and Customer Management, National Grid.
I don't know.
Mr. Cardinal. Councilors, I have spoken to Mr. Cardinal today and many times in the past. He also is joined by his colleague, Joe Carroll, from National Grid. And for those that have been around on the council for a long time, including the dean himself, Mr. Cardinal has come before us many times. He's always been a professional gentleman. He's always given us the information. I know Councilor Beauregard has also spoken to him. She, as the ward council, filed this resolve. So, Councilor, do you want to open it up?
Thank you again for coming this evening. The reason that we asked you to come before us is because of our concern with the 136 manhole covers. And as you know, we made the news again last week for a manhole cover explosion. Fortunately, once again, no one was hurt, but that is one of our largest concerns. So we were wondering where we were with this whole project. And we had had our chief of the fire department, Chief Williams, explain to us that he has been working closely with National Grid. So.
Before, just point of information on that also, just so I can let you know, because Larry Riley's not here, I did have a conversation with Larry in his capacity as the DPW commissioner about this, just to kind of piggyback on Councilor Beauregard. And Mr. Riley did explain to me that National Grid has changed out, and Mr. Cardinal can confirm this, most if not all of the manhole covers. And what Larry expressed to me to please explain to the council that they're vented manhole covers now. So the gas emission will dissipate into the air. So with that being said, thank you, Mr. Cardinal, if you could address the council.
Thank you, Council President Sullivan.
Thank you.
And fellow councilors for having me here tonight to provide you with an update on the three manhole incidents that have happened in the downtown, and also allow me to provide you with information as to our short-term and long-term plans to upgrade the Brockton Underground Network System. The three incidents that occurred on July 1st of 2016, January 16th, and March 14th of this year all involved secondary cables. Two of the three incidents involved paper and lead cable, and the third was called a cross-link polyethylene service cable. As these three cables failed, they provide us a spark, which led to the manholes being dislodged and the resulting outages. The third manhole incident, as you would probably guess, is still under investigation as we try and determine what caused that cable to fail. Unfortunately, it's not always clear what causes underground cables to fail, and we will be continuing with that investigation. In February, Chief Williams provided you with a good update on what our short-term and long-term plans were, and I will be updating you a little bit more on what has transpired since that meeting with the chief. And before I proceed, I'd like to say that your city officials, Fire Chief Williams, his senior staff, Commissioner Larry Rowley and his staff have been extremely helpful with us as we work closely and quickly to resolve these issues. Our short-term plan, manhole surveys. Physical manhole surveys are now completed throughout the downtown network by our crews. The last manhole was inspected this past Friday. All equipment has been inspected in each of the 140 manholes in the downtown Brockton network system, which serves approximately 4% of the city of Brockton. The remaining electric distribution system, which is overhead, serves the remaining 96% of Brockton customers and obviously is not affected by the downtown issues. During these inspections, all service ducts in the manholes have been resealed to minimize possible smoke, water, or any other foreign particle impacts inside customer premises. Primary cable, secondary cable, switches, fuses, cutouts, wall brackets, manhole structures, etc., have all been inspected, and a full report is being put together by our underground supervisor, and that will be created, and it will go to our engineering for a full review. Just in regards to the vented manholes, Councillor, 25 manhole covers have been changed from the solid covers to the vented covers, allowing any gases or smoke to escape with these vented covers. The locations are determined in line with the network and manhole designs. Special care has been taken as to where we place these vented covers so as not to allow debris to get into the manholes, which could, in fact, affect the integrity of the cable. So there was a decision not to go and replace all of them with vented. There wasn't a need to do that. They were strategically positioned throughout the downtown network system to eliminate any foreign particles from getting in there. The underground network infrastructure itself, we've cut clear any sections of cable that are not being utilized to serve customers right now. The engineering group is designing ways to serve some of the outlying customers that are on the outskirts of the underground system to be served off of the overhead system. And as we went through all of these 140 manholes, we had Clean Harbors with us, obviously trained and equipped personnel that went into the manholes before we did, and they were in there and they cleaned out any dirt, debris, soot, or any water or sewage seepage that had gotten into the manholes. And this is normal practice. When any of our crews go into a manhole, we make sure that they're cleaned out beforehand. Long-term plans. Using the manhole survey and inspections to determine and prioritize the needed repairs and or cable replacement. We have started replacing the secondary cable on Main Street, so you would obviously seeing our crews out there right now, and we will continue throughout the network system replacing cable as necessary. We are replacing right now approximately 20 sections of cable immediately, and at the same time as we put in the new cable, we're removing the old cable. The engineering group will be studying the future of the Brockton network in conjunction with the city of Brockton in the mayor's office on their planned economic development of the downtown. This collaboration will better assist in the future designs and replacement of the underground network. I have had, I believe it was last spring, I had a sit-down meeting with Rob May. He gave me his the plans for the city, for the Brockton downtown. So this, our planning engineering group has this, and as the downtown is being developed, we'll work on strategies to serve these customers. We will continuously look at these vented manholes to make sure that we have the right amount of them. That's something that will consistently being done. It's not standard practice. It's something that's typically not done in all areas, so we're doing this here to see if this is one way to keep any, you know, smoke from lingering inside the manholes, that it would come up quickly. And we're also looking at if any of the primary cable needs to be replaced in the underground system. Right now it's the secondary cable. And I also think it's important to note the investment that National Grid has had into the community, and just a little snapshot of how we look at things. Back in the early 2000s, we sat down with our planning group, and it was, okay, let's look at South Shore area, in particular Brockton. what do we need to do to upgrade the infrastructure. We looked at the overhead system, we looked at the underground system. Underground system was acting great. There was light load on the underground system, there were no outages, and there were no problems. So we focused on the overhead. We focused on the 96% of the Brockton customers, and we've spent upwards of in excess of $100 million on the overhead network system. The Auburn Street sub, which is located on the Whitman-Brockton line, we've spent $75 million over there upgrading that transmission and distribution system. The DuPont sub, which is located in Brockton off of Summer Street, we spent approximately $25 million there upgrading the overhead system to that substation. And we just recently completed the substation on the Avon-Brockton line, the Harrison Boulevard substation, where there's four new feeders out of that. And those feeders come into the Brockton area along with the Avon area. And that also allows us more switching points if necessary. If we have an outage, we can switch quickly to get customers back up and running. So the commitment is there, and now the focus is on the downtown underground system, where we are as quickly as possible replacing the cable, and we'll continue to engineer and design new ways to serve the downtown network as Brockton continues to grow in the downtown area and other areas of the city. We will continue to work with the mayor, city officials, and the economic development team to make sure that any customer that wants to move into the downtown will have a safe, reliable electric system. Thank you for the opportunity to update you on our progress and repairs. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
Thank you, Mr. Cunnell. That was really an in-depth, detailed update. So thank you on that. Councilor Beauregard.
Well, I'm going to defer to my colleagues first.
Okay. Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Cardinal. Quick question. I know with the first explosion, some of the businesses were closed for a short period of time. Now, do you know, as far as damages, if what we're looking at, maybe that Mr. Condon knows, is there an approximate cost of damages that were due to these manhole explosions due to the city?
Well, we ask customers when there's any issue to file a claim with us with our claims department. And I know there have been a few claims that have been filed, and some of them are still outstanding, waiting for information. My director, Joe Carroll, who is here tonight, has instructed the claims department to make sure that within due time that we reach out to everybody again, make sure that we're getting all the information that we need so we can make a determination on the claims.
So everybody has reached out to you to?
Yes, there have been a few people that have reached out and have claims in process, but not all the information that we need to process them.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Cruz.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Cardinal. A couple of questions. You mentioned as you were replacing some of the cable, you've been removing the old cable. But if I understand it, there's a lot of old cable from past that is not removed, correct?
Right now, the cable that's being removed is the cable that we're cutting clear and that we feel that there is no longer a use for it in the system. We're pulling that cable out. And any cable that looks like it might have had an issue with it, we're pulling it out.
And that's the coatings on the cable and all is what causes the toxicity when there is a fire, correct? So I get my question is, in the immediate future, will all of the unused cable be taken out?
That's a question I will need to get from operations. I didn't ask that one. I specifically asked them for anything new that they're putting in. Are they removing the old stuff? And they said that they were. I'll have to go back to them and ask them on the remaining cable that's in there.
You know, with brief conversations with the chief, you know, that cable that's not being used really needs to be gone. Also, I know the mayor and your whole company has said it's, you know, it's safe, everything is safe now. But we were told everything was safe after the first set of explosions, and then we had the explosions in the second, and we were told everything was safe, and then the third. Why do you feel, I mean, the vented covers totally make the system safe now downtown, or what makes you say that all of our people should feel comfortable now that there's not going to be an issue?
It's a combination of everything that we've been doing. It's the vented manholes, it's the manhole surveys, it's the removing of the old cable, it's the replacing of the secondary cable. It's the checking of all of the equipment that's in the manholes that's ongoing. without train crews getting in them. Unfortunately, the last manhole incident that we had the other night was one of the last manholes. We had not had the opportunity to get into that manhole yet. So we feel that because of our train crews have been in all of these manholes now, we understand what the system is.
And the first two were secondary cables that are fairly old, correct? But that third, when you're talking cross-link polyethylene, that's got to be fairly new cable, correct?
The polyethylene was not the third one. That was the first event.
Oh, that was the first event?
First event, yes.
And would that have been newer cable than what went in the other two?
It's still old. It might not have been as old as the paper and lead, but it's also older cable.
Okay.
Unfortunately, on the third one, it's still under investigation, so I don't really know the specifics on that one.
And the system itself, it doesn't just serve downtown Brockton, does it? I mean, I have to tell you that my own company, well, I have three branches on Cape Cod that were without service and they were told it was because of a fire in the Brockton downtown area. How does that affect the whole system?
It doesn't. It's just a small area, 140 manholes worth in the downtown Brockton area. If you want to think about the area where the last interruption incident happened the other night, that's the one end of it. The other end of it would be where the just beyond the post office would be another end. It's not a very big area.
Is there other services in the same spots?
WB Mason was affected the other day. They were actually not.
No, I guess I mean, are there cable? Are there phone? And are there other types of services in these same?
They wouldn't be in our duct bank.
I'll have to find out why they told us that the reason we had no phone and power was due to a fire in under the ground in Brockton.
Yeah, I don't know if there were other fiber optics or phone lines that would damage because of the...
Well, that's what I'm asking. So are there fiber optic and are there other vendors in those same areas?
They wouldn't be in our manholes. They wouldn't be in our duct system. They would be in their own system that is separate from us.
But in the same, or do they run parallel? Or?
They would not have access to our manholes. Their equipment would not be in our manholes at all.
Cardinal, they would have their own conduit running under the ground.
Exactly, yeah.
Each utility company would have their own. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
We have 1,397 customers that are served off of the Brockton network system in the city of Brockton, and we have approximately 37,716 customers that we serve in the city of Brockton. So it's about 3.8% of the total population of the city of Brockton.
And do you think you can get me that information at some point, whether you're replacing, removing all the unused cable?
Absolutely.
That's under there? I'd
yes.
be interested in that, because I think it's very important that that's done. So,
Scott,
thank you.
If you get that info for me, I'll get it out to
great.
The council.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor Cruz. Councilor Rodriguez?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Cardinal, how are you?
Great. How are you?
I'm glad you actually answered one of the questions that I had, because my question was, how many paying customers do you have in the city of Brockton? And you said it was 36,000, I believe, right?
37,000.
37,000.
Yes.
Okay. Now, let me ask you a question. With 37,000 paying customers, why did it take so long for National Grid to be at this level that we're in now, knowing that we've had three incidences that could have been deadly in this city? I don't know if you know or if you've seen the way these manholes kind of blew up the way they did. We're actually lucky that not a single person was injured in this situation. Why is it that it takes National Grid, knowing that we have 37,000 paying customers? I mean, these are not freebies. These are people that are actually paying their electricity, because if you don't pay it, it gets cut off, so you lose it. So you got 37,000 paying people. Why is it that the city basically has to sit here? And you just answer the question that my colleague from Ward 1 actually posed to you, where we've got a ton of cable still remaining in these ducts that you're still debating whether or not you're going to remove it. But at the same time, again, remember, you have 37,000. I'll bet you if you put all the communities around Brockton together, it does not equate the number of clients that you have in the city. Why is it that it's taking so long for National Grid to react the way they should have reacted?
Well, we reacted immediately after the first manhole incident happened. That's when we started right away beginning the manhole surveys and trying to determine what was causing it. And I think it's important to remember that the cables are not dead that are sitting in the ground that have caused the incidents. They're cables that have voltage going through them that have caused it. So that's something that's also important. The cables that Councilor Cruz is talking about would be just removing cables that are no longer in use.
Right, but if you have a fire in those manholes, those non-used cables will begin to do what? Ignite and burn. Correct?
Not necessarily.
But they will.
Yeah. The spark comes from the...
No, I'm saying once you have a fire in the manholes, mm-hmm. you know, and the thing is burning, if you have any sort of combustible materials in those holes, it's going to burn. And the cables will do the same thing because they got casings, protections, and all that stuff around it, and it will burn. And God knows, I had a conversation with the fire chief not too long ago, and he was saying that some of these wires have been in those manholes for almost 100 years. So if you've got 100-year-old cables sitting underground that's no longer being used, why in God's name would National Grid not take them out to prevent further incidences in those manholes? And the thing is, I know you mentioned that only 4% of the clientele are affected by these manhole issues, but it's in the middle of our city, and people are traveling all over the city on a regular basis, both residents and visitors in and out of this community. So it's not just the 4% that it affects, but the entire city itself. I mean, some of us are frankly tired of watching television and seeing, you know, Brockton in the news again because downtown is burning. You know, we've had 3 incidences since July. Mm-hmm. You know, when's the next incident? I mean, when is it going to happen again? You know, and frankly, to be honest with you, you're honestly lucky, because if I hadn't had the conversation with the fire chief, this discussion wouldn't have been like this, because some of us were pretty ticked off by the fact that an organization such as National Grid is playing games with 37,000, you know, clients of yours. And I'm sure if these issues had happened in Newton, Wesley, and some of these other more affluent communities, we would not be sitting here talking about an incident that took place in July and repeated itself again in March.
Counselor, I do believe Mr. Connell did address, and he answered Mr. Cruz in terms of to try to find out if there's obsolete cable in the ground that needs to be taken out. He's not a construction ops guy, so I appreciate that question. But he doesn't know the answer to
it. No, Mr. Chairman, I'm not saying that he knows the answer, but he's here representing National Grid, and he needs to take this message back to National Grid saying that some of the officials in this city are regularly ticked off by the lack of response of National Grid, and we're not going to put up with it. You know, because this city is not, National Grid is not donating electricity to Brockton. It's collecting a great sum of money from the city, and we've had these instances. How can you sit here and say that we've had 3 incidences since the summer? And that's not a major concern? And if the wires are sitting in the underground where they could pose additional issues, why are we not removing those wires?
Counselor, I can respond in the fact that, please don't put words in my mouth by saying it's not a major issue. I never said that.
No, I'm saying that.
Okay. But you made off like that I was saying it. And I've also said earlier on that we have spent over $100 million in the city of Brockton to upgrade the electric infrastructure. We looked at the time when we decided to spend the money on the overhead system, the underground system was operating properly and there were no issues with it. Now that we see that there is an issue with it, and we started on July 2nd, the day after the first event, we've decided with our engineering and our operations group is how best are we going to fix the system and how quickly can we do it. And that's what we're doing right now. Money's not an object. It never has been. And we will continue to provide safe, reliable distribution system for the residents of the city of Brockton.
Well, I'm not saying that money is an object, but the fact is that you have 37,000 paying customers. You have to respect those 37,000 people that are paying their hard-earned money for their own safety and the safety of folks in this community. You had the first incident in July. Since then, you've had 2 other incidences. So you couldn't have done a very good job in July to fix the problem, because we've had 2 additional ones. My question is, when are we going to get a next one? And if you're not willing to take out the wires, the old wires that are sitting there, what makes anybody in this community think that we're not at risk if National Grid doesn't act the way it's supposed to?
I feel confident that our supervisors and our dedicated trained personnel that have gone into all of these manholes since July 2nd, these 140 manholes that they're surveying, and they're determining what needs to be done, what can be done quickly, and what we can do as we move along to make sure that the system is safe, and that's exactly what we're doing.
So when can we expect to see a completion of this whole of these issues that we're facing here in the community, so then you can come back and say, I can guarantee you that the manholes in the downtown area are now non-existent as far as problems are concerned?
Well, my group will be constantly updated by the underground as they proceed along. They told me that they will be replacing secondary cable for the next month or so, I believe, out on Main Street, replacing that cable. Again, the manhole surveys have been completed. That information is with our engineering group, and they're determining long-range plans. But they feel that now that they've been in every single manhole, they've had a chance to inspect every single one, that they're comfortable with what they found, what they removed, what they've cut, and what we're replacing.
So you're saying that we should not see the issues that we've had in the last 6 months or so in these manholes?
I believe that they're comfortable with what they have seen and what their short-term and long-term plans are for the system.
And when will you know whether or not, when will you know when those wires, the old wires, the non-usable wires are going to be removed from the...
I'll find that out this week.
I appreciate it.
Yes.
Thank you much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. President. Thank you for coming and explaining kind of what's been going on, because as, you know, just a resident too, this last one was actually right by my house, and it was close enough that, you know, I was concerned, as I understand that where it was. But I just have a question. So historically, and I'm not sure if you'd be able to answer this, and you may have to go back to the engineers or to the operations department, when was the last time incidents like this happened in the city of Brockton?
I'm not aware of, I mean, I've been working with the company for 27, 28 years. I'm not aware of any of these incidents in the past.
Okay, so in addition to some of the, you know, the science that you explained there for what some of the reasons are, could it also be maybe in a boost in development, construction, new clients kind of, you know, getting in? Because, I mean, around that area, there are several new housing developments there, you know, hundreds and hundreds of new clients, you know, coming up to that 37,000 individual or paying customer number. Is that something that can agitate an old system and then cause it to be combustible? Or
the engineering group looks at all of the underground and overhead feeders to check the electric load on them to make sure that the system is not overloaded, just mm-hmm. as you would check your main breaker in your house to make sure it's not overloaded. This mm-hmm. the downtown network system is not overloaded. Remember, there's only just over 1,300 customers that are on the underground network system, not the 37. That's the 37 is the overhead system. 1,300 is okay. The underground system. It's very lightly loaded, and that's why back a few years ago when the planning was going forward and we went overhead with mm-hmm. all of the upgrades, is because the underground was running smoothly, there were no outages, and it was lightly loaded. And
so now,
it's still lightly loaded.
So with you saying that, that makes me think now. So now you have the plan, the you know, Brockton future plan. It includes several housing and, you know, business district new customers. Is that going to then make it overloaded?
We would look, depending on the load of the new customer that comes in, we would look at and determine if we need to bring in new primary cable, new secondary cable, new transformers, whether they'd be, the underground network is underground, so we'd want to bring those up above ground. So when each customer decides they want to come in and they provide us with their proposed electric loads, then engineering determines what's the best way to feed them. Would it be a new primary system? It's an option that they'll be looking at. If it's on the outskirts of the network system, mm-hmm. we might say we'll serve them overhead.
Okay. So now, even with that, this is probably woulda, shoulda, coulda, if you said that you guys have already spent $100 million and some change in kind of renovating the underground, the issues and things. don't want to say wouldn't it have been more prudent to, not that you have that plan in your hand, to have made that upgrade, preparing for that to happen, instead of now when people come 2 and 3 years down the road, if it ends up being an overload, then you're going to have to do this other overhaul, or that there may be some more problems, or something like that?
Well, obviously this plan that I received from Rob was last spring. When mm-hmm. we determined to spend the money on the overhead system, that was approximately probably 5 to 10 years ago when that plan started.
But I'm just saying, so this, you got that last spring with the proposed projects or some of the submissions or things that, you know, our wish list for Brockton for the most part. So that was in the spring. That very next summer, we had our first explosion, which started the reconstruction for the underground system. That's what I'm trying to say. So did you repair it to the way it was right before it blew up? Or did you repair it to be able to take additional usage?
We're repairing all of the secondary cable, or I'm sorry, we're replacing all of the secondary cable because that's where the issues are. Primary cable is where you would feed the majority of the load. And if we have to bring in new primary cable because of the load of the new customers, that's what we would do.
Okay. And again, just so the area, you said, you know, right over by like the post office, you said?
That's one limit of it. Just beyond the post office, you can see the overhead lines. Just beyond where the last manhole incident happened last week would be the other end. And then it's up on North Main Street. It's not that much further up, going up North Main Street as it does up Montello here. It's the same distance.
Okay, yeah, because I saw them on Montello, North Montello, doing
right.
something up on
the So then if you go up on to Main Street, the underground system doesn't go much further than what you, as far as Montello goes either. The same distance heading north.
Okay. I guess I don't want to kind of keep on the same track as my colleague over there about predictability, because these things are not predictable. But it's just, I guess, since you're so focused on the downtown, I get that you looked at the 130, 140, whatever, in the downtown, do we need to be concerned about some of the other manholes in, say, for instance, like down by, like the Kmart or, I don't know, wherever, up Ward 1 or something, Torrey Street, like these places that haven't had a problem? Do we have to worry about that, too?
The networks, the Brockton Underground system is just a small area right here in the downtown.
Oh, so everything else is above head. I see. Okay.
And that's where the investment was made in the overhead system.
Got it. Okay, I understand now. Thank you very much. I appreciate you clarifying that, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Beauregard.
Okay, thank you again, Mr. Cardinal, for coming this evening. I just wanted to go over two things here. My colleague, Councilor Azak, had mentioned that people can file claims. What happens? There's an explosion. Do you notify the businesses that have to be shut down because they don't have power, or they lost all their produce and, you know, that's what they sell or that's what they serve to their customers? Is that one of the steps? Because there were, what, 4 or 5 businesses affected in July, for example. So that's one question I have. So does someone assist them in filing this?
So the customer, typically when they call the claims department will say, is, you know, did you file a claim with your insurance company first? And then this is what we need from information from you, from what happened, you know, the date of the incident, what you lost in that incident. And file that with us, and then we would go and deal with the insurance company to see what they had filed a claim with them and what type of money they would have received from them. Because obviously we can't double dip, obviously. So we gotta make sure that everything is done correctly. So there are still claims that are outstanding. I believe there's still claims that we're looking for more information. So we've asked our claims group to reach back out to everybody that has a claim and speak with them.
Okay, and would this also include individuals that live in apartments in that area, for example, if
anybody felt that they lost something because of the power, whether, you know, it was a piece of equipment or anything like that, they can certainly file a claim.
Okay, thank you. And the other concern I had, and this had been brought up by our fire chief, that when we have these explosions, there's toxins and gases in the air. And I always remember in July, you could smell it. And you can almost see it in the air. Granted, it's warmer and the air seems to be more humid and thicker. But also, what I'm wondering, when you said that they're vented now, are we getting toxic fumes that we don't realize coming into our atmosphere in the, you know, in the area?
No, there's not any normal release of gases at all. You know, what happens when the cable has its failure to it, there's a spark created, and that's when it would have a, you know, it would get combust with existing gases and smoke. So the idea was, if it was ever to happen again, that the vented manhole would prevent any type of explosion of the manhole, of manhole cover would not release.
The toxins. Okay. Thank you very much.
Councilors, I gave a little leeway on that. I think Mr. Cottle did a good job. I mean, the insurance aspect wasn't part of the resolve.
No, I understand.
But I think it was important, and I think Mr. Cottle did a good job on that. And I will speak to him this week to follow up on Councilor Cruz and Councilor Rodriguez, and I will get back to you on that. Any other questions for the invited guest? If not, I entertain a motion.
Move this favorably.
Second.
Motion is made, properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor? All opposed? That motion carries. Mr. Cottle, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Carroll, too. We're going to go back to Madam Clerk. We're going to go back to agenda item number 9, please.
Order appropriation of $462,200 from the stabilization fund to various departments to provide funding for the collective bargaining agreement between the city and Brockton Association of Engineers and Inspectors in accordance with the cost items of the memorandum agreement. The CFO, in accordance with Section 5 of Chapter 324 of the Acts of 1990, certifies the proposed appropriation of $462,200 for purposes of funding the collective bargaining agreement between the City and Brockton Association of Engineers and Inspectors for fiscal year 2017 only. This is a conditional certification. For fiscal year 2018 and beyond, a certification cannot be provided due to the city's expenses increasing more rapidly than its revenues. While this particular contract is not significantly increasing the city's cost base, the city will need to raise more revenues or reduce services. Nonetheless, the agreement is fair and in the interest of the city and its union, and recommends the funding of it. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer.
Condon, good evening.
Good evening.
Mr. Condon, you know where the mayor is on this?
On this particular...
Do you know where he is tonight?
Where he is specifically? No, I know he wasn't able to make it, but I'm not sure where he is specifically.
Thank
he
you.
And I talked about it, and obviously he submitted the appropriation. We've had a series of contracts that have been settled before now. We've settled with the laborers, the clerks,
you,
the water and sewer union, the trades union, and the city employees union, which used to be called HLPE. So those contracts have all been settled all the way through fiscal 19. And we're in fiscal 17. Two of the contracts before you tonight are for the same pattern, 17, 18, and 19. This first one's a little bit different because with the engineers and the inspectors, we did not get settled in time to get the 14, 15, and 16 settlement in front of you. So the contract before you basically extends without any economic change the old agreement and then provides for fiscal 17, 18, and 19 an agreement which gets them made whole as if they'd settled earlier, and that's why this contract is a bit more expensive because some of it is retroactive. The basic terms are that for the fiscal 17 year retroactive, or rather fiscal 16 year retroactive July 1, 2015, they got 5.86%, and that's the compounded effect of a 2% and then a 2% and then a 1.0125. So basically it's the same pattern as the other union settled on. You compound it out, it becomes 5.86%. And there was an additional 0.5% in there in this contract as there was in the earlier contracts because they gave us the concession allowing us to install GPS devices in their vehicles and to record calls on City Hall telephone lines. So the contract is truly comparable to the contracts of the other unions that were settled for that same period, just more expensive because it hadn't been settled in the same time frame. For fiscal 17, 18, and 19, it's the same pattern as the other unions also. It's a 2% for this fiscal year, and then on July 1 coming, another 2%, and then the final year is 1.75%. And there are some other cost items in the contract which add up to another percent or two over the life of the contract, as there were in other ones. They vary a little bit depending on the union, depending what they were seeking. Basically, it's the same kind of contract as we've settled already with those other five unions. And so the conditional certification I've placed on it is basically because we're facing difficult budget times. We all know that. It was true. I gave conditional certifications on the other union contracts. But we're obliged to try to come to agreement with our unions. These contracts on base wages are coming in at a little bit less than inflation. Other communities are settling on a similar pattern or perhaps a little bit more, and that's why I recommend this particular contract be funded.
Thank you, Mr. Condon. Councilor Fowle, followed by Councilor Barnes.
Good evening, Mr. Condon. One cannot read your conditional certification without feeling very concerned. Mm-hmm. You and I have been through a lot, and when I see you put down here that the city's expenses are increasing more rapidly than its revenues, it has to be a warning sign. And you're only certifying this through FY17.
That's right.
Presuming the same level of state aid, and in view of the rising expenses of the city, if we were to approve this, what do you see the consequences to be? What can you reasonably forecast might be the consequences to the city's workforce?
Okay, I think we've got basically a couple of choices. I don't think the state's going to come galloping into our rescue. We're basically getting from the state for general fund appropriation just lottery increases every year, and it's a modest amount. And they've even backed off on the level of increase they've been giving to the school budget. And that's a matter for another day, but for general fund purposes, I've felt for several years now that the city, you're probably not going to want to hear it, and I know the mayor doesn't like it, I think that the city needs to be each and every year fully appropriating 2.5% allowed under the law. We don't have the revenue base that allows us the leeway to leave that tax appropriation or that tax levy on the table when it only takes a recommendation by the mayor and a vote by the council to appropriate it. So we've got sitting in reserve right now, in a sense. It's not in a reserve account, but it's an amount that could be appropriated if the mayor were to recommend it and the city council were to agree to it. $3 million, which wasn't levied this year and was allowable under Prop 2.5. For next fiscal year, you'll have that $3 million again, because 2.5 will basically grow the levy by that amount. Plus, you'll have new growth, probably another $2 million. So I think it'll take a tax increase, but I think the appropriation can be afforded if the city would be willing to put the property tax levy in play, as almost every community in Massachusetts in the same circumstances as Brockton does. The communities in Massachusetts which don't fully levy the property tax allowed under 2.5 are basically very, very wealthy communities. They're able to throw a little bit of the levy increase into their budget every year, and that property tax base is so high they're able to get away with it. I don't think we're able to afford doing what we've been doing. If you've read my budget letters, you know I've taken that position in the letters. I think I've said it on a couple of occasions publicly. Second, we need to be certain that what we do in our utility funds, where we can measure the use of a service and charge a full recovery rate, we need to make certain that the rate that we're imposing on the users is a full recovery rate. That's true in the sewer budget now, that's a good thing. It's true in the refuse budget, it's a good thing. But it isn't, I think I just lost my mic. I guess it doesn't like the message either.
No.
it's not true in the water fund. And in the water fund, we're subsidizing water ratepayers by the tune of about $2 million every year, because we've not levied the full amount that would be necessary for the water budget to pay its own way. And some of those costs are being paid by the general fund because they have to be paid, health insurance costs and pension costs. Now, the council a year or so ago finally increased the water rates. We're getting caught up, but it's a phased increase. And by the time we get that last increase accomplished, we'll be right back in the position we were again. I'm sure the Water Commission, if they were here in front of you, would tell you the same thing. So with those steps, we'd be in a much healthier position. I'm not going to say we'd be out of the woods, because I don't think we would be. We're still a property tax poor community. We're still a community where many of the residents don't have an awful lot of extra money, and they're mightily resistant to paying more in taxes and paying more in fees. I don't blame them. I know that it puts a pinch. But if the state's not going to give more assistance to communities like Brockton, then we're going to be left with one of two choices: cut services or raise revenues, or I guess the third choice is a combination of the both. So that's my answer to your question, Councillor.
All right, so drilling down to the basics, if everything stays static, you're predicting that at the rate we're going to have reductions in personnel.
Probably so, if you don't fully appropriate what's available for appropriation, yes.
Okay, and I don't suppose you have any numbers or departments or, because I realize we don't govern the language in a CBA, but once we approve this, we're in fact putting our imprimatur on the negotiations. And when I read this, I become very concerned that we're almost going down the same path we did in 1989, 1990, when we overestimated revenues and we spent funds that we
didn't
have.
I think there's a big difference, Counselor. We're not overestimating revenues. We're generating free cash every year, and we're generating retained earnings every year, which means that you're underestimating revenues and generating a surplus. In that old case, we were not fully appropriating costs, and in fact, bills were coming in that couldn't be paid because an appropriation wasn't sufficient. That's not the case anymore either, because you wouldn't be generating those surplus amounts if that were the case. So there is a difference. The same problem, though, is that in that earlier period, the city's political structure, the voters, the elected officials, in combination, weren't willing to pay the full cost of the services they were enjoying. That's true here, too. The problem that you just described isn't happening, but the other part is. So I think it's within our power to fix it. There's one more place where I think, and you know it from every time we've gone out for a capital project or a construction project. My recommendation has been, if you want to be certain that this isn't going to cause an impact on the general fund budget, go to the voters and ask them for the approval to pay for it with a debt exclusion or a capital exclusion outside 2.5. That money goes away as soon as the capital project or the debt has been paid for, so it's not permanent, but it means that there's an amount of money coming in each and every year certain to pay for those services or for that cost without affecting other services. I've said that on every borrowing. There's never been a willingness to put those kinds of questions in front of the voters, but almost every community which does construction projects does do that and makes a case to the voters and obtains the recommendation back, yes, it's okay in our view to do that, and they're not in the same condition that we are. Almost all the projects, by the way, that we've gone out to borrow for are being subsidized by the state, 80, 90, 70%. So we're not doing it 100 cents on the dollar. We're doing it in the case where we're getting assistance. And all I've been saying is we probably ought to be picking out 20, 10, 30% by asking the voters to do it. Would have helped. We didn't do it. So now we're sitting on a circumstance where it is probable that we're either going to have to push more taxes at our taxpayers or we're going to have to reduce services. That's
all right. Specific to this appropriation, it's my understanding that I guess for 20 years we've had certain positions that are paid overtime to stand by their phone in case they're needed for overtime.
Some are, yeah.
Are we funding any positions in this budget, this $462,000, that are part and parcel of this standby overtime provision that I understand exists in certain collective bargaining agreements?
I'll have to get back to you on that, Counselor, and research it. What you've said is true. Whether that's in this particular funding request is, I don't think there's anything new in this that would affect that, but I'd have to get back before I answer that question.
But I'm sure you can see where I'm coming from.
I understand where you're coming
from. The average person in the public doesn't understand why would we pay someone to stand by in case they need it. Just to help you out a little bit, I believe there were two new positions created in DPW last year, and I think they're trying to, the union may have wormed their way into the standby overtime in those positions, and frankly, I'd really want to know that.
Okay, so this is engineers, technicians, and inspectors. I don't believe that particular provision applies to this contract, but I don't want to state that unequivocally because I'd have to research it.
All right, and by the way, that question would pertain to all of the appropriations you've asked, so if you could, as we go through these different agenda items, if you could get back to us with that, I'd like to know it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. Condon, I just have a question about, and I don't even know if this would be something that would be under your purview. It might have to go to legal, to the solicitor's office. So I'm not too familiar with unions. I've been in a few, but never negotiated all that stuff. I just enjoyed, you know, the end result as an employee. So negotiations, are they opened? Okay, so so there's no way that we can see whatever or you know, the back and forth, if there was even a back and forth, because you said several times, and you said it before, that a lot of these things are just the same language as before. So if we're not negotiating kind of a best case scenario for everybody involved, that makes me concerned, because you've come with this condition, you know, for at least the last 3.5 years on several of these contracts, and that just makes me nervous that we're not negotiating for our best interest. And I mean, if we're just going to cut services and raise taxes, there's got to be another step before we get to that point.
What makes you think we're not negotiating with vigor at the negotiating table, Counselor? What I've
said is... Well, it's because you said that they're the same ones as the contracts previous.
Point of information, if I could, Counselors, remember, under our former government, the administration vis-a-vis the mayor sits down for collective mm-hmm. bargaining to negotiate. The legislative body does not have that, unfortunately, that ability.
But Counselor, what I said is they're settling on the same basic pattern. Once you've settled with a major union, it tends to be repeated. That basic wage pattern tends to be repeated with the other unions. That's what I said. And then in the specifics, there are exchanges for particular language that the city seeks or particular concession that the city is looking for, and it's traded for something else. But it's very, very typical that the base wage pattern, which I just described, 2-2 mm-hmm. and 1.5
right.
and then the second one, would be the same from one union to the next, because they wouldn't think they were being treated fairly if it weren't done that way.
Right, but if everybody, this may not even, well, now that I know they're not even public, I mean, it's kind of a moot point, but if these are being submitted with your dire conditions, you know, these 2 and 3 year extended contracts, and you can only kind of certify for 1 year, then maybe that pattern needs to change. And that's what I'm trying to say, like, where's the negotiation in that? If last year the contract that you negotiated came with this condition, and then you're still using that same formula and that same strategy, they're going to continue, and like Councilor Farrell said, just kind of keep kicking this can down the road, and if, you know, the future administrations, if they continue to not use the 2.5, we're going to be in a lot of trouble. And then especially, like you said, then we have these other increased charges, and our revenues aren't coming in, and if we continue to have lawsuits and things that we've, you know, kind of seen as of late, we're going to be in a lot of trouble. So I'm just, I guess, and again, so this really wasn't for you. It would probably be for legal, but if they can't tell me anyway, I guess we'll just have to sit
I can tell you that we're at the table for months, and there's, each of these contracts is separately negotiated, but the first contract, the one that's in front of you now, is part of an umbrella group, mm-hmm. the 1162 Laborers Union. Mm-hmm. These are all cousin unions under the same basic umbrella. When there's a contract settlement, that word gets out to the other union members under that umbrella. Mm-hmm. It is not easy to get to agreement. The reason this particular agreement wasn't settled at first is that we wouldn't give the engineers, technicians, and inspectors a different deal than what was received by the other unions. That's why it didn't come before you in time. They didn't get the full benefit of what they would have received retroactively, because it didn't apply to their overtime. There were monies that they didn't get by delaying. So we do negotiate. It doesn't mean that you get to an agreement which is unfavorable to either party. If you're negotiating in this fashion, you're going to get to an agreement where both parties are winning and losing. In the case of the money piece, my view is, absent the lawsuit issue that you just talked about, my view is you are obliged under the law to negotiate in good faith. You're not obliged to fully appropriate your levy, but it's expected by the other side that the city will do what it's able to do under the law mm-hmm. to pay for the pay raises that it's negotiating. We haven't done that. The mayor's not going to like that when he hears it on television tomorrow, but we haven't done it. He knows what I think about it. I think you know what I think about it. You might, had he suggested, let's put more money into the stabilization fund, for example, out of the levy, you might have said, no, we don't want to do it. Leave it on the table. The taxpayers need it. Still, it would have been against my advice. My point is, we need to pay the employees a fair settlement. I think if you don't do it, you're going to have people you're asking to jump into ditches in the middle of the night when a water main breaks to do it without a pay increase. I don't think they're going to be happy about that, and I don't think it's fair to ask them to be happy about that. With respect to the question Councilor Farrell asked, some of those kinds of provisions have been in the contracts for many, many years. You can try to extract them, and when you do, you end up in a mighty fight. The question is it better when your labor force is somewhat constrained? And it is. If you would look at the staffing positions in the city of Brockton, say 8 or 9 years ago, on all of these general fund budgets, including the Water Commission's budget, and compare it to what you've got working right now, you would see in department after department, every single one of them has suffered either layoffs or attrition over the years, and we're asking the employees not to do less, but to do at least the same, and in some cases more. So I think the settlements are fair. They've asked for a fair bargain. I think it's a fair bargain. It isn't their fault that the city's finances are constrained. All I'm saying with that certification is you need to be doing this with your eyes wide open. I don't want to have layoffs next year or attrition next year or the year after that. And you say to me then, where was your warning when we needed it? You need to vote this contract according to what you think is best for the city and the workers. You have 8 votes needed to pass it because it's coming from the stabilization fund. If you don't think it's a fair settlement because of the city's present conditions, you have every right to vote no. I mean, you've got your own minds and your own consciences to handle. All I'm saying is, I think it's a fair settlement, notwithstanding the city's constrained circumstances, because we're asking these workers to do work for us, and the amounts that they're getting in the contract settlement are outrageous. They're basically inflation.
And I understand a man is worth his hire, and you know, should be paid for what they do. But you know, when you have seniors that live on a fixed income with their Social Security, and they haven't received a COLA in 3 and 4 years, that's also very unfair.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
I mean, those are the kinds of things that I'm thinking of kind of going forward. And again, thank God that there are people out there, you know, in the manhole, in the ground, especially that last winter when it was brick ice cold out there and all of those things. Thank God. But I mean, you can't say no to someone's pay when they're doing the job that you won't do. And I mean you as in me. But I'm just saying, you know, with all of these kind of concerns and the conditions that are put on it, again, I just...
Yeah, that's my obligation under the law.
Right.
I don't think I'm shirking it by saying what I've said. I think know that I think it's a matter of concern. It is a matter of concern. We all need to be concerned about it.
Okay.
I'm not saying that we should be less concerned about the people who aren't getting these increases, who are either working in the private sector for less of a rate of increase or who are retired and aren't getting increases in their Social Security or their pension. We ought to be concerned about them, too. I just think the city is in a bad position. We're not wealthy by property. We're not wealthy by income. I think if you look at what the city does for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts in terms of the kinds of students it's educating, the kinds of things we're doing for an immigrant population, even if you think maybe we should be doing more, we're doing more than most communities in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And I don't think we get adequate help from the state. And I don't think there are many of you sitting up there who would disagree with that statement. So I think when Prop 2.5 was put in place, the expectation was that the state would be helping these communities because they took away the ability of the community to raise the taxes except for that annual increase. I don't think they've lived up to their bargain in the last 10 years. When recessions began in the early 2000s and again in 2008, they cut big appropriation numbers. Some of those numbers affected only urban communities like Brockton. And that money has never been restored. I don't have the math in my head right now, but I think it's something like on an annual basis, state aid for unrestricted purposes, down about $10 million from where it was in 2008 every year. Do 10 years times 10 million, you got $100 million, don't you, that we would have had they just maintained what was there in 2008. That's the source of the problem. To me, it's the state walking away. That's the source of the problem. So what do we do about it? You know, we're not going to be able to force them to do more. The state delegation can't do more. They're working. We're just kind of stuck with the result.
Can we sue them, like the school?
I think we would have a better chance if we were fully appropriating the levy.
Oh, okay. Uh-huh.
Personal opinion.
Excellent. Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Ms. Condon.
Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Condon. A quick question for you, I'm going to be one of those that say, you're not preaching to the choir here, because tax increases, I don't think it's something that we're going to be talking about right now, so we might as well leave it alone. How many individuals or employees are affected by this particular increase?
This particular
contract?
In terms
of number. I know he talks about some of the unions the negotiating bargaining parties in the sense, but how many individuals is that affected?
I'm going to guess at it because I don't have that right in front of me, Council. I can get you that number too, but I think it's probably 30.
Just 30 people?
In this particular union, yes.
Okay.
Mr. Condon, you might have an answer. Do you have an answer for?
It's like 25.
Pretty close. Yeah. So
approximately there you go, 25.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. And also, I mean, Councilor Barnes brought that up in terms of negotiations for folks that will be watching us tomorrow, not tonight, right? Who sits on a typical negotiation session? I know that you've got the unions, but from the city side, who actually sits at these negotiation sites?
An attorney, sometimes two, the person sometimes outside, sometimes inside, and this it's an inside attorney, the city solicitor's attorney,
okay,
the personnel director, and me.
Okay.
That's your team.
So there's nobody from the mayor's office or his staff at all?
No, but with respect to union negotiations like this, we sit with the mayor at the beginning and we keep him apprised as the union negotiations progress and get his input as to where he thinks we can end up and where he thinks he couldn't support it. So he's not at the table, he's involved in the process behind the scenes.
So typically he basically says, you know, we probably can afford 2%, 1%, or whatever the percentage is, and then you guys go on and do the negotiation.
How does that work? He tends to set an outer limit and say, can you get me inside that limit? And we try to get there, and if we can, we say we need to move here or need here if you can approve it. And you know, he knows what's going on in the negotiations. We keep him apprised, and the final deal has to be approved by him. It's subject to the mayor's approval, subject to the ratification by the city council, subject to the city council's approval of the funding.
So basically the 462,000 people are gonna go to 25 people.
Yes, but it's covering, for this union, is covering from the fiscal 14, 15, 16, and 17. It's covering four fiscal years.
Okay, so actually past years, not necessarily current years.
Yes, and it's retroactive in full. So basically, if you were to get a pay raise of, say, $5,000 a year for three straight years, you know, we owe you five for that first three, that's 15, and then another five and five for the second, that's 25, and then another five for the third, it's 30. It's not just the 15% because going back to the beginning, piling it up, going back to the second year, piling it up. That's what drove that number up.
Now, what's the logic behind, I mean, if you look at this particular one, you're saying that technically in 2018, we're at it again.
Yeah.
Which is just a
year
from now.
This particular union, no, will be settled for this union and the unions that are in front of you now will be settled through fiscal 2019.
Okay,
through fiscal 2019.
I thought you just said that it's for 15, 16, 17.
This union has two pieces to it, the contract for 14, 15, and 16, which was extended without any additional compensation, but we made them partially whole on not getting to agreement during that period. And then 17, 18, and 19 is the next 3 years. There's a total of 6 years covered by this, two to come, four behind.
And when you're negotiating a contract, what are the minimum terms or the maximum terms that you normally recommend? Is it just a three-year deal, a five-year deal, or how does that work?
Well, the state law restricts any single contract to 3 years. You can't do it more than 3 years, and you can't go back more than 1 year. So that's why this particular contract is 1 year back for the three that they didn't get anything on, then 3 years going forward.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Conner. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Rodriguez.
Motion recommend favorably.
Second.
On the motion, I just want to say, as chair of this committee, I am disappointed that the mayor's not here. I think it would be very important to have him here since it's his budget coming forward relative to this. It's great that we have Mr. Conner here, and we appreciate his expertise. But without having Mayor Carpenter here, who ultimately agreed to settle and gave them the parameters to negotiate, we're at a disadvantage as a legislative body, and I will let his office know that tomorrow. Councilor
Yaneri. If I might, Mr. Chairman, because just on that, on the motion and listening to Mr. Condon and everything that he's been discussing this evening in regards to the whole financial process and how we get to this particular level, I do have to say in all the years that I've sat here, I think the certification that's before us is the same one that he's put before us for all those years that I've sat here.
Mm-hmm.
Because the fault is 2.5%. And the fault also lies with the fact, and I hope that the mayor is listening, that we just can't leave that $3 million on the table. We can't. We've got to start to utilize it. I agree with you in some points that we need to do something with Proposition 2.5, and I think we've tried that over the years.
Yep.
Whether we have to try it again, we may have to try it again. Because I think we all need to be awoken to the fact that we're going to be in deep, deep trouble in this next year or two, right from the federal government right on down to the cities, because that's how it works. Federal, state, and then what the city gets. And what do we get? We get the bottom line. And that's the difficult factor that we're going to have again. I think in getting back to negotiations, I think the people that are there negotiating in the best interest of the city, doing the best that they can, and they're also doing it to make sure that the employee gets the fair pay raise or increase that they should be getting. It's too bad that these folks had to go so long. And I hope that we don't have to do that in the future. We don't know that. But in any case, and be fortunate, councilors, because I know you don't like me saying it, but when I was a school committee member, negotiations is no easy task. It really is not. Time consuming. I did it on the teachers union for 20 years. Thank you, Mayor Fowle. He made sure that I was there to do it then, too. But it's never easy. It's not easy. But in a case like this, all we can say is when the mayor prepares his next budget, he's got to really be, we've got to be at that line whether we like it or not, or we're going to have deep problems. But anyhow, thank you, and thank you for a good job, too, Mr. Condon. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor Fowle.
Yeah, Mr. Condon, I do appreciate all of the time that goes into collective bargaining. We've been through it.
Yes, we have.
I am going to vote.
It hasn't changed in 20 years.
It hasn't. I will vote favorably. However, pending receipt of the information on this standby overtime, I always reserve the right to vote differently at
Absolutely.
The council level.
Absolutely. I understand that, Councilor. I do understand
But thank
that.
You for your efforts and the other team members.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilors, we have a motion properly seconded on the floor. Favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor? All opposed, that motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Madam Clerk, if we could go on to the next agenda item, please.
Order appropriation of $59,700 from the stabilization fund to various departments. The CFO, in accordance with Section 5 of Chapter 324 of the Acts of 1990, certifies the proposed appropriation of $59,700 for purposes of funding the collective bargaining agreement between the city and department heads union fiscal year 2017 only. This is a conditional certification for fiscal year 2018 and beyond. A certification cannot be provided due to the city's expenses increasing more rapidly than its revenues. With this particular contract, it is not significantly increasing the city's cost base. The city will need to raise more revenues or reduce services. Nonetheless, the agreement is fair and in the interest of the city and its union and recommends the funding of it. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer.
Mr. Condon, good evening.
Okay, councilors, this is a little bit different. This is just for the fiscal years 17, 18, and 19. This is for the Department Heads Association. Some of us department heads are paid by ordinance. Others are member of this department heads union. This is for the members of the department heads union. The pattern on the base wages is the same. It's the 2 to 1.75. There is an increase for others in there because of a insertion of an educational incentive of 1% for a degree at any level. It's not pyramided. It's 1%. And the sick leave buyback, which was increased in the other contracts at the retirement, went to the same amount, $13,800. I think there are about 15, if I'm not mistaken, in this particular union, for whoever asked that question before, the number of members, I think it was you,
yeah,
Councilor. There's about 15 in this union. As you can see, the number, their compensation is higher, they're department heads. And the amount of the appropriation request is just under $60,000 because it's only for one fiscal year.
Move for favorable recommendation.
Second. On the motion.
Motion, Council Barnes.
Thank you. I just have a clerical question. So in looking at the side letters in the back, the side letter of agreements, there are several of them that aren't signed by the solicitor or the solicitor's representative or the mayor, but they're signed by the union folks. Is that just we got the
Because
early
the
copies or whatever?
The contracts, one of them I think we had the mayor sign, he shouldn't have signed. He's agreed and he submitted it, but the contract really isn't approved until the city council has approved the funding. So that's the reason for that.
So they'll be signed?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We have a motion on the floor properly second. Favorable recommendation back to council. All in favor? All opposed? That motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Madam Clerk, number 11, please.
Order appropriation of $80,000 from the stabilization fund to the library personal services, other than overtime $79,000, and library overtime $1,000. To provide funding for the proposed collective bargaining agreement fiscal year 17 to fiscal year 19 between the city and the library union in accordance with the cost of the memorandum agreement. The CFO, in accordance with Section 5 of Chapter 324 of the Acts of 1990, certifies the proposed appropriation of $80,000 for purposes of funding the collective bargaining agreement between the city and the library union for fiscal year 2017 only. This is a conditional certification. For fiscal year 2018 and beyond, a certification cannot be provided due to the city's expenses increasing more rapidly than its revenues. While this particular contract is not significantly increasing the city's cost base, the city will need to raise more revenues or reduce services. Nonetheless, the agreement is fair and is in the interest of the city and its union and recommends the funding of it. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer.
Councilors, this is for the library union, both full and part-time employees. They're all members of the same union. Again, it's just for the fiscal year that we're in, with 2 years to follow, 17, 18, and 19. The basic pattern is the same. For this particular group, almost all of the people who are working in the library are required by the state now to have master's degrees, and so we've increased their educational incentive to give them an incentive to get it. Most of these folks, if you look at the budget book when it comes out, These are professionals, mostly, not exclusively, but mostly women. They're not especially highly paid, and I was enthusiastic about inserting that particular increase into the contract because I think it's fair. You're asking to be educated. They ought to get paid as professionals. But anyway, I hope you approve this one as well.
Motion to recommend favorably.
Mr. Chairman, on the motion, and I'm just going to ask you for a little leeway because something just came into my head.
Okay.
Mr. Condon, how are we doing with regards to the snow budget?
I think we were in pretty good shape until
a little
this month, and we probably exceeded it at this point, but I don't know that for sure. So all the bills for the storm of a week ago have come in, but up until that point, we're pretty close to being all right.
Okay, all right. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You think by the end of the week, maybe you could just get that?
I'll get that information to you too.
That'd be awesome. We have a motion.
Just on the motion.
On the motion, Councilor Neary.
Mr. Condon, yes. If you might, just refresh my mind. What's the amount in the stabilization account?
Do you recall? I think it was about $5.8 million, something like that.
I know it was given to us a few weeks ago. I thought it was around that area.
Yeah, it's just under six. Does that sound about right?
Yeah. I think that's correct. Okay. That's fine. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We have a motion on the floor. It's a properly seconded favorable recommendation back to council. All in favor? All opposed? That motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Thank you, Mr. Condon.
Thank you, councilors.
We're going to go to number 12, Madam Clerk.
Order appropriation of $329,190.60 from the Executive Office of Public Safety and Securities Fiscal Year 17 Senator Charles E. Shannon Community Safety Initiative Grant to the City of Brockton Police Department Fiscal Year 17 Senator Charles E. Shannon Community Safety Initiative Grant Fund. These funds will be used to pay for police overtime, Father Bill's Main Spring Coalition Work Express Graffiti Removal Services, Old Colony YMCA Street Outreach and Case Management Services, Fiscal Management Services, Parole Officer Expenses, Mentoring for Youth through Brockton Christian Mentoring Initiative, and Massachusetts Youth Committed to Winning. The match consists of in-kind services only. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, and Chief John Crowley, Brockton Police Department.
Chief Crowley, good evening.
Good evening.
How are you, sir?
I'm good, thank you. Yourself?
Thanks for being here. Thank you. Do you have any information you want to provide? Or
this is the Shannon Grant. I've had it for approximately 10 years, and it's... we've been fortunate enough to have it.
Thank you, Chief.
Motion recommend favorably.
Second.
On the motion, Councilor Fowler.
Just on the motion, Chief, at some point we've had a lot of grants come in and they've mentioned police overtime. Yeah. And you may remember we had to make somewhat of a time-sensitive transfer of money to the police department for overtime. So at some point, could you give us a summary of where we are now? How much money from all of these different grants are going to take care of the overtime needs of the police department?
I brought this with me tonight. This is specific to the Shannon Grant. The city took a $100,000 cut in what we received last year. Directed towards the police department overtime this year is $41,400 out of that money. Last year we received $54,400.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Council. We have a motion on the floor.
Mr. Chairman,
on the motion, Mr. Rodriguez.
Chief, just a quick question for you. In reading the order here, it says that some of the funds actually go to pay for a parole officer's expenses. What does that mean?
That's part of the grant is police officers go out with parole officers to check on parolees that live within the city. And part of this grant pays for their overtime to go with us.
Oh, pays for the overtime of parole officers?
Yes.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chief, is that standard practice relative? We've had this Shannon for 10 years. Is that standard practice?
Yes, I think their dollar figure is $7,000.
Okay, thank you. We have a motion on the floor. It was properly seconded. All in favor of a favorable recommendation back to full council? All opposed? That motion carries. Thank you, Chief. It's a favorable recommendation back to the full council. Madam Clerk, number 13, please.
Order appropriation of $500 from Spectra Energy Foundation grant to the City of Brockton Fire Department Spectra Energy Foundation grant fund. These funds will be used to purchase a 4 gas meter to monitor air quality at emergency scenes. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Chief Michael Williams, Brockton Fire Department.
Chief Williams, good evening.
Good evening.
Thanks for being here.
Welcome.
Do you have any, it's a small dollar amount.
Yeah, it is. We've received this grant several years in a row, and this year we plan on buying the gas meter with it.
Motion to recommend.
Second.
Motion made properly.
On the motion.
On the motion, Councilor.
I just want to ask a question. Right. So this is a
actual gas meter. Where will it be? Where is it, or where will it be?
It will be stored on the deputy chief's vehicle, so it'll be available to travel the city wherever it's needed.
Oh, okay, so it'll be mobile.
It's stored. It's a handheld unit.
Okay.
It's stored in the back compartment of car 56, which is the deputy chief's vehicle.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Chief. Thank you.
We have a motion on the floor, properly seconded, favorable recommendation back council. All in favor? All opposed? That motion carries. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
It's a favorable recommendation back to full council. Have a good evening, Chief. We're going to go to agenda item 14, please.
Order appropriation of $22,460 from the fiscal year 16 Emergency Management Agency Planning Grant, EMPG, to the City of Brockton Emergency Management Agency Planning Grant, EMPG, fund. These funds will be used to purchase a utility task vehicle, no match required. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Stephen Hook Jr., Director of BEMA.
Favorable recommendation.
Second.
I have a question, please.
I'm going to have Mr. Conan come forward. I don't see Mr. Hook here, but Mr. Conan is here.
Yes.
On the motion, Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to ask logistically, so in the rendering here, is this like a modified golf cart? Like, is this some kind of special emergency response? Yeah,
that thing. It's a street vehicle.
Okay.
It's a street vehicle for the. Looks like it's got more than golf cart capabilities to me. It's got a 3-cylinder engine, fuel injection, hydraulic power steering. I've been on some golf courses. I don't remember getting that.
We'll let you drive
it. It does look a bit like a golf cart. It's more like an all-terrain vehicle, but it is a street vehicle.
Okay. Oh, okay. So it is a street. I just wanted to kind of figure out exactly what this thing is. But okay.
It's even avalanche gray in color.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Ms. Conner.
Thank you, Councilor Barnes. We have a motion on the floor, properly seconded, a favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed? That motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Conner. It's a favorable recommendation back to full council. We're going to go to agenda 15, Madam Clerk.
Order appropriation of $2,000 from the 2016-17 Hazardous Materials Emergency Preparedness Grant to the City of Brockton Emergency Management 2016-17 Hazardous Materials Emergency Preparedness Fund. These funds will be used to purchase miscellaneous equipment and supplies, no match required. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Stephen Hook Jr., Director of BEMA.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made, properly seconded.
And on the motion, want to spare Mr. Condon from having to expound on this particular agenda item. So.
Motion made, properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back to council. All in favor? All opposed? That motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Thank you, Council Farwell. We're going to go to agenda 16, and please remember Commissioner Rowley had indicated he's unable to join us tonight. So if we go to 16, please.
Order that the City Council approves the changes to the Water Commission rules and regulations set forth in the February 23rd, 2017 letter for the Water Commission. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Larry Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Ryan Creedon, Water Systems Manager, and Ozzie Jordan, Water Commissioner.
Mr. Jordan, good evening. How are you?
Thank you. Very, very well. I wish you'd put my proper title on there, Chair of the Water Commission.
You know what, Mr. Jordan, I don't do this agenda, but it'll be duly noted. Thank you.
Been a while. Okay, this is a change in rules and regulations of the Brockton Water Commission. Originally was approved in June 16th of 68, was modified in February 21st of this year, of 17. And what we're dealing with is water connections. It's under part one. Wait a minute, I need the other piece of paper. If I may. So I can read you. I think you all received it as an email.
H and J?
Yeah, we have it.
Yeah, I don't know if you had a chance to look at it or not, but it's the title to real property, Mass General Laws, estates and for years in that will, 186 section. It gives the definitions, and submetering is, in essence, the piece that we're talking about. What we changed was in section one, letter H, and it was talking about a multiplex or apartment or commercial building may, at the owner's request and expense, be provided with one bill to be issued for each service of the city main, and the other was J, and this was added. This was something added new, basically just picking up the state regulation and incorporating it into our policy. Property owners interested in submetering must comply with all requirements set forth in Mass General Laws, Chapter 186, Estates for Years, and at Will, Section 22, and Section 105 CMR 410.354. We sent this over to legal. Legal came back with one minor change to us. It was a just a clerical change. So other than that, that's it. And what it does is to have the large multiplexes and apartment houses to have one heater coming in if the for the city's purposes. If the landlord wants to sub-meter, he can do it as what the state law says. That's basically it.
Mr. Chairman, when you say you sent it to legal, do you send it to city solicitor or our legal?
City solicitor, I'm sorry.
So to the best of your knowledge, Attorney Gilday, our legal counsel hasn't seen it?
I don't know that, to be honest with you.
Okay, thank you.
Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
The motion on the floor is properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor? All opposed? Motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Councilors, I will check with Attorney Gilday on that.
Okay.
We're going to read 17, and then, as I said, Senator Brady. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Creed, for being here. Senator Brady is unable to join us, but he will come at a later date. So if we go to the last agenda item tonight, 17.
Resolved to invite Senator Michael Brady to respond to the City Council inquiries as to the status of the Ganley Building. Invited Senator Michael D. Brady.
Councilor Beauregard.
Yes, I filed this resolve, and as you all remember, last month, that the DCAM, the Department of Capital and Asset Management and Maintenance, did not, attend. So we spoke with Senator Brady, who had been speaking with our Lieutenant Governor Polito on the issue of the Ganley Building, and also the department, DCAM. And now he is unable to attend. This was a last-minute meeting. He will come to the next Finance Committee meeting and asking that this issue be postponed. And we're currently continuing to review this concern.
Councilors, before we take the motion on that, remember there's also another resolve that I filed last session. It's been postponed about the Ganley Building. And I will even be a little more blunt than our colleague in Ward 5. They didn't show up, they didn't notify us, they didn't decan us, they didn't have the decency to contact us as elected officials to say that we can't attend. So I'm glad that you've invited the senator to come before us. I still think it's in the best interest to get the Ganley Building back. We were sold the false bill of goods. Council Rodriguez.
Mr. Chairman, I think as a suggestion, you know, often we in this city, we get pushed around so much in this community. It's interesting how we can barely get our own officials to show up at the council meeting. You know, some of us have other things that we could be doing as well, and we're here, you know, doing the best we can in this to run this city. I mean, things are presented to us. Sometimes we don't have a say in what happens other than just, you know, yay or nay in some instances. But I, you know, to be honest with you, it's a sense of disrespect when the Commonwealth does this or the city does this. So why don't we go a little further, and I'd like to add to your motion or the motion from the council from Ward 5 to ask the Lieutenant Governor to come before this before the City Council. If a letter gets sent to her and she chooses not to show, she'll know at least that she got a letter. Because I think we sit back way too far and just, you know, we're so happy to, you know, it just happened here with earlier on today with, you know, it's agencies that work with this city, it's government officials who are supposed to be doing this. But you know what? We're so thrilled that they're showing up and thanking them for being here versus to say, you know what? You do have a right to answer to the taxpayers in this community. So if DCAM hasn't shown, I think we need to go above DCAM and ask for the Lieutenant Governor. If she doesn't show, the next time we do that, perhaps we ask for the governor to come. You know, because we do have that right and that authority in this Commonwealth as a regular city and within this Commonwealth. I think we need to do that and exercise our right to do that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I like that idea. Thank you. And, Constance, since this is your resolve, do you accept that?
Yes.
It will be postponed,
we'll
but also
up.
As an invited guest, other than Senator Brady, Karen Polito, Lieutenant Governor, will be invited?
Exactly.
Yes.
Okay, that's a motion on the floor to postpone until the next finance, and I will make sure that the Lieutenant Governor is invited along with a reminder to Senator Brady. All in favor?
Yes.
All opposed? That motion carries. It's postponed, Madam Clerk, to the next FinCom meeting. Again, if we can make sure Lieutenant Governor Karen Polito is invited. Councilors, before we adjourn, I just want to thank Council on Aging, Janice Fitzgerald, Michelle. Almost all of us were at a wonderful event last week that the seniors love. It was on one of my favorite holidays, St. Patrick's Day. It was last Friday. And if you were able to attend, and if you weren't, you were there in spirit. But it's always just a wonderful time to be at the council. It's always packed, and people really appreciate what we do. So it's a really feel-good day. Greek Independence Day is coming up soon. There was a flag-raising ceremony last Friday here at City Hall for the Irish, and that's going to be continuing for other nationalities as well. So I do want to open it up if there's any moments of personal privilege.
If I might, Mr. Chairman, I just want to remind those that sit on the Accounts Committee that we'll be having a meeting next Tuesday evening, March 28th. That's Tuesday evening, March 28th, 5:15 p.m. I should say late afternoon, but 5:15 p.m. in the GAR room.
Thank you, Councilor Yannieri. Council Farwell.
Yes, just a public announcement meeting. The ZBA meets tomorrow. However, there are three issues of significant public interest, and I was asked to announce that the matters of 583 North Carey Street, 343 Linwood Street, and 685 to 697 Pleasant Street will not be heard. They will be heard on April 11th.
That's right.
So those three will not be on the agenda for tomorrow night, and those interested parties should mark April 11th on their calendar.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Lally.
Moment of personal privilege.
You don't have to stand, Councilor. Oh, yeah, thank you.
Right. Sorry about that.
He's young, he can stand.
He's young. Yeah, I'll do it anyway. Show how committed I am. I just wanted to announce again that I'm having a ward meeting March 29th. That's a Wednesday at the Brookfield Elementary School at 7 p.m.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Bond.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to remind my colleagues and the folks at home that this Saturday will be our annual Winter's End Ball. We're going to shake off some of the snow and cold and get dressed in our finest skivvies and cocktail dresses, tuxes, everything. Saturday the 25th from 7 to 12 midnight, it will be at the Brockton War Memorial. There will be, I think, a live band, a DJ, cuisine, catered cuisine, just a good time for everyone to, like I said, just get dressed up and shake off the winter blues. And we have a special Muse Award awardee this year that the community will know and will love. The tickets are $35. And they are available at Tuxedo by Marion, which is located right here on Main Street. So if you're inclined to go, we would definitely love to have you there. Be advised that the tickets are selling like hotcakes. So if you would like your ticket, I would advise you to get it before Wednesday because they are selling fast. So
thank you, Council.
Thank you.
Anybody on this side? Seeing none, this meeting is hereby adjourned. Have a good night.
Thank you.